Aging is an essential aspect of biological life, and we as humans experience aging at every second throughout our lifetimes. From the moment of birth to the moment of death, we age, and our bodies reflect this process via physical and cognitive changes. So, in this three-part series, I'm exploring aging from birth through adolescence. Then I'll explore how our brains age in young adulthood to middle adulthood. We'll finalize the discussion by exploring how our brains can age from middle adulthood and beyond. In doing so, I'll have covered all aspects of the human brain as we age throughout the lifespan. Also, if you haven't already done so, hit that subscribe button and select that bell so that you never miss a new episode about that thing in your head. No, not those thoughts on how badly wrong your relationship is going. We've all been there. But the brain. Unrelated, but did you know that children under the age of 5 do not have patellas, also known as kneecaps? I know, right? That randomly popped into my head. But you're not here for my random thoughts. You're here to learn about how your brain develops across the lifespan, specifically how the brain develops from birth through adolescence. Let's start by getting a closer look at the brain. Our brain consists of two types of cells. The majority of those cells are glial cells, which occasionally transmit information to other cells in the brain, but are primarily responsible for insulating and nourishing our second cell type, neurons. Neurons are the communicator cells, while glia are the supporting cells. Focusing on the neuron, a healthy adult brain contains more than 100 billion neurons and is estimated to contain more than 60 trillion neural connections. Neurons form connections with each other at the synapse, and these connections allow our neurons to communicate with one another, creating information processing networks. These networks are responsible for generating our thoughts, feelings, and actions. Most likely, it is surprising to no one when I state that babies are born with extremely large heads. However, human babies are the only known species so dependent upon caregivers for such a long period of time. Also, at birth, we are very helpless, especially compared to that of other species, even other primates. For instance, in order for human babies to be at the same maturation of newborn baby chimpanzees, human babies would need to undergo a gestation period of over 20 months. As opposed to the current 9 months. This is because our brains are highly underdeveloped upon birth. The most prevalent theory as to why this may be the case proposes that due to our ability to walk upright on two legs, an ability known as bipedalism, the birth canal is limited in size, resulting in a head and brain that is smaller at birth in order for it to pass through the birth canal a little bit more easily. However, a newer theory proposes that human babies are born extremely dependent on their caregivers due to the limitation in metabolic energy of the mother, resulting in a gestation period of about 9 months. Whatever may be the case, the result is that upon birth, the brain is 30% smaller than the adult human brain, and we have a very dependent baby. The brain undergoes major changes during childhood. It is not until around 7 months old that the nervous system develops enough so that infants can do very basic skills, such as grasping objects, laughing, sitting up, and beginning to formulate language sounds, the babbling stage. It's not until 6 years of age that the brain reaches about 90% of its full size. Changes that occur during this time period is where the concept of neuroplasticity originates. Neuroplasticity is the idea that information processing networks can change based on experiences. Regarding neurons, the creation of new neurons is called neurogenesis, and the vast majority of neurons are created prior to birth. And studies showing neurogenesis into adulthood are mixed. I'll discuss this in more detail in my next video. But the important thing to note here is that these brain cells may not generate after birth, or may be generated in very limited instances after birth. However, connections these cells create among other cells can change. These connections between the synapse and the dendrites of other neurons are known as synaptic connections, and can be either created or destroyed. In fact, about 40,000 synaptic connections are formulating between each neuron until a child reaches the age of 2 years old. And generally speaking, that is more connections than you will ever use. As such, an event known as synaptic pruning begins around the age of 2, and where many of the unused connections are severed. It's problems with the synaptic pruning process that have been associated with autism. Should I make an episode about autism and the brain? You know what? Comment below if you'd like to see an episode pertaining to autism and the brain. Back to synaptic pruning. pruning, this is a major brain event that has been found to last a few years. And by the time a child reaches 10 years of age, 50% of synapses that were present at the start of the event are gone. And the connections that have been strengthened by repeat use are the ones that remain. Thus, synaptic pruning is a genetically coded event that takes place in an ordered fashion, but the connections that remain are shaped by one's environment. One important thing to note is that the development of the brain in healthy individuals are both dynamic and adaptive, and differences in how brains develop may emerge in the presence of environmental deprivation or enrichment. It is well documented that brains can, and often do, develop differently based on a variety of factors. The most damaging is being exposed to stressful conditions, which have been shown to result in brains that appear to have undergone damage, particularly in the hippocampus, an area of the brain responsible or related to memory. So moving on a few years into adolescence, I don't know how to make that a transition, but here we are. If you've ever gone through adolescence, it should come as no surprise that those years can be extremely tumultuous. This clear change in behavior from childhood and adulthood have actually baffled neuroscientists, as it does not follow the same kind of linear pattern seen in the other two large age development brackets. It is for this reason that adolescence is considered a transitional period. Adolescence is marked with higher emotional reactivity to often mundane events. So what exactly accounts for this complete shift in behavior from being a mild-mannered young child to being an absolute nightmarish teenager? Like most everything, there's probably a combination of environmental and genetic factors at play, as is the case with synaptic pruning seen in early childhood, where genetics determined an ordered time-sensitive process, but the environment determined the synaptic connections that remained. So the behaviors I'm referring to are impulsivity and risk-taking behaviors, which would be pretty straightforward to examine, right? No, of course not. This is human neuroscience, not rocket science. So naturally, risk-taking behaviors and impulsivity involve completely different brain mechanisms, because why wouldn't they? Additional periods of synaptic connectivity loss and fine-tuning occur during adolescence. These brain changes may correspond to some of the behaviors often seen during this period of development. The two most notable areas of development throughout childhood, and especially into adolescence, are the prefrontal cortex and subcortical areas, such as the basal ganglia and the amygdala. Loss of gray matter is a typical pattern of development often seen in childhood, which becomes more pronounced during adolescence, particularly in the prefrontal cortex. But this loss accompanies an increase in white matter. This change in white matter is again mostly seen within the prefrontal cortex and areas of the brain connecting the limbic system with the prefrontal cortex. Development of higher connectivity between the two areas are associated with age. These changes to the frontal limbic areas are both functional and structural. Structurally, researchers have found increases in white matter and decreases in gray matter. Documented functional changes have shown a shifting of neuronal recruitment within the prefrontal cortex from a more diffuse pattern of recruitment in childhood during tasks involving impulse control that shifts to a more concentrated recruitment of neurons in adulthood. And these changes seem to be more pronounced during adolescence. What does all this mean regarding the behavior of some teenagers? As mentioned, adolescence is best described as a transitional period due to both the linear and nonlinear changes seen over this time period. These changes, since they both do not follow a straight and predictable trajectory, create a brain developmental mismatch. And due to individual variation, some experience this mismatch much more than others. Development of regions regarding impulsivity and emotional reactivity are developed before the area of the brain that checks and moderates these brain areas, the prefrontal cortex. Prefrontal cortex is the last area to fully develop, and on average is not developed until around the age of 25. Thus, the behavior seen in adolescence is likely due to an interplay between the overdeveloped limbic system and the underdeveloped prefrontal cortex, an interplay that includes the development of connections between these two distinct areas in the brain. These findings have a lot of implications on how teenage criminality is treated, as many who work in the field notice a real gap between the findings and the laws, especially as some teenagers are prosecuted as adults. But this discussion is for another day. In this episode, I discuss some major brain events which occur during childhood and adolescence. Next episode, I will discuss the aging brain into young and middle adulthood, and when age-related cognitive decline begins, as it may be younger than most believe. If you like what you watch, make sure to subscribe to my channel and share with family and friends. Also, make sure hit that like button. Also, if you want to support my channel with big brainiac energy, then head on over to my Patreon page to become a contributing member. And as always, thank you for feeding your brain with brief brain snacks.